Every good and perfect gift comes down from our Heavenly Father, who does not change like the shifting shadows. And so those blessings continue today and every day. His grace, His mercy, His peace be yours in abundance as you consider the great gift He has given to you in His Son, Jesus, and the wonderful gift of heaven. So we want to focus on that first lesson is we ask the Holy Spirit to strengthen our resolve to keep God as our top priority in life, that we might serve Him and thank Him for all that He has done for us. Let us begin with a prayer. Heavenly Father, bless us by your Holy Spirit that you keep our hearts focused on your love and how everything we have comes from you, how you have given to us that wonderful gift of heaven. May all these things help us in our daily lives as we seek to serve you and to love you by how we talk and how we speak and what we do. We pray this in your holy name. Amen. I don't know if our daughters realize that I am the best dad they have ever had. Now, give me a moment here. Have you ever had a dad who mows the lawn for you and washes the dishes, who's cleaned up after you, who takes you to Michael's and to AC Moore, both of those stores, to find your perfect little toy that you wanted? Have you ever had a dad who, like me, will make you scrambled eggs before school almost every morning of the week, if you ask me? A dad who will watch Beauty and the Beast with you on a Friday evening? I bet you have never had a dad like me, right? And you are going to do whatever you can do to make sure you don't lose me. All joking aside, obviously we can't pick our fathers. But when it comes to things in life, don't we look for the best? We strive to have perhaps the best car, or we would really like to have the best house that fits us, or the best job. Maybe it's the best college as we think about what we want to do with our lives, what kind of career. We're going to pick the college that works best for us. As we get older in life, right, we want to have the best perfect vacation or the best retirement that we might have. And again, there's nothing wrong with wanting that best, but the problem is when we come to the point when we think we found the best and we just latch onto it and that's all that life is about. We can be deceived by the world into thinking, this is what makes my life complete. This is going to give me all that I need in life. And it's kind of like having tunnel vision or the blinders on. And if someone's going to tell us otherwise, we're just not going to believe them. We're just going to focus on and enjoy what we have because this is the best thing ever. Well, having the motto, only the best will do, it's not a bad motto, not something bad to strive for. But as we learn from scriptures, oftentimes what we perceive to be the best thing ever, what we really got to have, what our life is all about, those things actually can turn into idols. If you've ever read Tim Keller, he's a pastor, I believe, up in New York City, and he wrote a book called Counterfeit Gods. And he describes the human heart as an idol factory. And this is, he explains why. He says, the human heart takes good things, like a successful career, love, material possessions, even family, and turns them into ultimate things. Our hearts deify them as the center of our lives because we think they can give us significance and security, safety and fulfillment if we attain them. Wasn't that what Jesus was sort of making a point in the gospel lesson? He said, I have come to turn a man against his father, a daughter against his mother. He said before that, I've come not to bring peace, but a sword. And his point is, faithfulness to me and following me sometimes means you have to go against even family. Because we live in a sinful world, and we have sinful family members, and we are sinful. And sometimes we decide to go against God's word. But our calling as disciples is to help each other. And that means sometimes the tough road, conflict. And Jesus says, I've come to turn father against son, mother against daughter, because that's what they need. They're too focused on themselves, or they're too focused on their children. They're not saying the right things. So to be faithful to me as a disciple of Christ, to keep me as number one in your life, you got to say something. Right? And that's going to cause conflict. That's the sword, right? There's going to be issues within your relationships. Well, this whole idea of idolatry is something that's not foreign to any of us. We're all susceptible to focusing on the things of this world, because that's kind of how God has designed us. He's designed us to want to know him, to follow him, to worship the ground he walks on. But with the fall into sin, we come to the reality that we are born into this world without true knowledge of God and true faith in God. So how can we journey through life carrying out our purpose to worship God if we don't know him? And so naturally, people will turn to the world and they will find something, strive to find something that will fill that void of knowledge and purpose. But as Pastor Keller brought up, as we know from our experiences, anything and everything outside of God will finally, eventually, disappoint us. Anything and everything outside of God finally will lead us to despair, because the things of this world, even our closest friends, they can't solve our biggest problems, right? Our guilt and the reality that one day we're going to face death. That's what makes the story of the golden calf such an incredible, maybe unbelievable story. At the same time, we can certainly relate. If we're honest with ourselves, we find ourselves in the children of Israel, because we too easily lose focus on God and where all of our things come from. We too lose sight of how it is we have survived this long in our lives. We too can forget, like the Israelites, well, all the success we've had in life, finally, we can't pump our chests and look at me, right? That's that honest reflection of the abilities, the talents, the success I've had. Finally, that comes from God. So before we point the finger too quickly, God's word requires that we daily assess our hearts to figure out what is the passion of our lives. What do we desire the most in life? And where do they fall in line with our love and our obedience to God? Because only God is everything that we need. Just think about the Israelites. What more could they want in a God? What more could they ask for in a perfect heavenly father? They had become the most powerful nation probably in the world, so much so that the leader of Egypt, who was known as perhaps the leader of the then known world, the Pharaoh, the leaders of Egypt, they tried to exterminate the Israelites to no avail, but they were afraid of the Israelites. But they had nothing to do with that. The merciful Creator had handpicked that nation out of all the nations of the world to be his special people, but it had nothing to do with them. They were so precious to him, as we remember some of those stories. Remember those plagues? Some of those plagues God only sent upon the Egyptians, not his precious people. And not only did God provide for them an escape route through the Red Sea, he saved them from the pains and the sufferings of hell by binding himself to a promise he couldn't break because he's the perfect God. He would always forgive them. And regardless of how they behaved, he was always going to keep that promise of eternity. It's no wonder that their heavenly father was so disappointed when he saw what they were doing down at the base of the mountain. So beside himself, so angry that at that moment he wanted to strike them dead, right there on the spot. It was only because of Moses' pleading that God relented. But what else could they have asked for? Of all the people in the world, God picked them out because he's a loving God, and he wanted to demonstrate to the world what a wonderful, loving God that he is, and they got to be the example. What else could they want to look forward to? The promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey, the promised land, an eternity of God's grace and mercy and love in heaven. They had forgiveness on countless occasions, and every time they would repent, God was going to forgive them. They had promises of protection and prosperity and peace. They were divine promises that couldn't be broken. They had the best, and they had nothing to do with it. For you and me, it's the same, right? Only the best will do for you and me. That's what we need, and that's what we have. Like the Israelites, we are constantly searching for direction in life. We're constantly looking for that someone who can provide protection and perseverance to life. We're always looking for something outside of ourselves to bring peace and prosperity. And finally, only the best will do. Only the best will do to deal with our sin and guilt. Only the best will be able to protect us from this sinful world and preserve us for life eternal in that blessed home of heaven. Only the best, God, gives us purpose in life and promises when we die. Only the best knows what's going to happen today, and he's already planned for how your life is going to turn out tomorrow. What else could you want? Only in God is everything that you need. Anything and everything else in this world eventually are going to disappoint you, and we don't necessarily do it on purpose as family and friends, but we have our limitations. The things of this world have their limitations. You ever noticed how you think you found the best thing ever, and maybe 3 months later you found something else that's the best thing ever? We're always looking for the best, but we can never find it in this world. But in God, only in God, we have everything we could ever need. As the Israelites kind of came to their senses, at least some of them, Moses had some very endearing, comforting words. As the priests rallied to Moses' side to honor God and to say to God, "Yeah, Lord, you are everything that we need," Moses said this: "You have been set apart to the Lord, and he has blessed you." Not because they were great priests, not because they had done such great things, but because the Lord is gracious and merciful. The Lord has set you apart, and he has blessed you. He set you apart from this sinful world by making you his son or daughter. God set you apart from the guilty and the condemned by washing you clean of your sin, guilt, and shame, acquitting you of all the things that you've done wrong. The Lord God has set you apart. He has blessed you, setting you apart from those who have earned for themselves eternal death and hell. He's done that by making you an heir through the power of baptism, right? An heir alongside with Jesus himself, having that inheritance of heaven. When you really think about it, only God is everything that you need. And so may the Holy Spirit give us wisdom to see what our 401 really is. Right, to see our best car for what it really is. In line with the gospel lesson, may the Holy Spirit enable us to see our family for who they are. Right, they're people who need to hear the law so that the gospel can heal. As painful as that might be, as much of a sore that it might be in your relationship, That's what they really are, souls who need Jesus. May the Holy Spirit, as we consider our discipleship in life following Christ, may he help us understand and see what our career really is all about. The things you do in this life are ways for you to say thank you to God, using your talents and abilities to the best of your ability. May the Holy Spirit grant us the wisdom to see our money and time for what they are. They're ways in which God provides for us, but they're ways for us to show our love for him, to use our time and our money to honor him and to serve him, to share with others that wonderful gospel message. May the Holy Spirit empower us as we pray for vision, right? To see the things of this world for what they really are, to see the time that we have in this life for what really is. May he give us strength to keep God as that top priority in everything that we say and do. So as we do every Sunday, as we do each and every day, let us celebrate that only in God is everything. We have everything that we need simply in our relationship with God. We do that in song, we do that in prayer, but we also do that in everything that we say and do. As we follow Christ through thick and thin, as we follow Christ to carry out his gospel ministry, may he always remind us that finally, only God is everything that you and I will ever need. God grant us such a vision in life and purpose in life as we strive to serve him. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God, which continues to flow through the cross of our Savior Jesus, bless you and keep you as you serve him now and always. Amen.